each other biologically, to the earth chemically, to the rest of the universe atomically.
I think nature's imagination is so much greater than man's. He's never gonna let us relax.
We live in an in-between universe where things change all right, but according to patterns, rules, or as we call them, laws of nature.
I'm just not standing on a planet. Really, I'm just a speck. I'm just a speck compared with a star. The planet is just another speck. To think about all of this, to think about the vast emptiness of space. There's billions and billions of stars, billions and billions of specks.
The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. The cosmos is also within us. We're made of star stuff. We are away. The cosmos can know itself. Across the sea of space, the stars are others. We've traveled this way before, and there is much to be learned.
We're all connected to each other biologically, to the earth chemically, to the rest of the universe atomic.
Find it elevating and exhilarating to discover that we live in a universe which permits the evolution of molecular machines as intricate and subtle as we.
I know that the molecules in my body are traceable to phenomena in the cosmos. That makes me want to grab people in the street and say, have you heard this?
The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. The cosmos is also within us. We're made of star stuff. We are away. The cosmos can know itself.
There's this tremendous mass of waves all over in space, which is the light bouncing around the room, going from one thing to the other, and it's all really there, really, really there. But you gotta stop and think about it, about the complexity, and really get the pleasure. It's all really there, really, really there. The inconceivable nature, nature. To think about all of this, to think about the vast emptiness of space.
There's billions and billions of stars, billions and billions of specks.
The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. The cosmos is also within us. We're made of star stuff. We are away. The cosmos can know itself. Across the sea of space, the stars are others. And we've traveled this way before, and there is much to be learned.
That was the Talking Alternative Radio Encore broadcast. We hope you enjoyed it. Now, for the live shows, professionals serving community, talkingalternative.com.
evening. Welcome to Employment Law Today. I'm your host, Eric Sauver. I'm an employment law and business law attorney, and I host this weekly live talk radio show and this live podcast every Tuesday evening from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m., where I have interesting guests and we discuss very pertinent employment and business issues that business owners face in these challenging times. And so after that very long introduction, I'm happy to introduce my guest tonight, who is Ms. Dawn Verbrigghe. Dawn, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Eric.
Sure. I joke because the intro music was a little longer than I usually have, but I don't know how much was actually recorded of that, that you and I were sitting through there for a moment. But in any event, appreciate your being here. I just want to tell our guests, or rather our audience tonight, a little bit about the show and our topic for this evening. Mm-hmm. And our topic for tonight's episode of Employment Law Today is DIT websites and silver linings to pandemics. And the topic really involves the discussion of the fact that with the COVID-19 pandemics, this virtual new world that we're all in, many of the in-person methods for business, for advertising, for gaining exposure, and for demonstrating our sophistication, a lot of these methods are not as available as they once were. And the days, right, and the days of sponsoring cocktail hours or giving seminars live in person are coming back, but they're still, I think we have a while to go. Mm-hmm. And so now more than ever, having a professional online presence, like a modern accessible website, a digital marketing campaign, and advertising strategy is crucial for business success. And so on tonight's episode, as mentioned, our guest, Ms. Dawn Verbrigghe, the CEO and founder, I should say, also of Jottful, a company that works hand-in-hand with small business owners to build websites and online presence, will be discussing this issue and also discussing Jottful's very interesting story of how they pivoted their business model a bit during these challenging times and how they basically invigorated their company. And so we'll discuss some of Dawn's businesses and how they overcame the pandemic-related responses. So Dawn, I want to, before I get to our questions, I want to, again, just give maybe a better intro of you, or a more, I should say, just in-depth intro, if I may, before we get to our, great. And so, I actually jotted this down right here for us. So I want to tell everyone that Dawn has served as the head of marketing at four venture-backed software companies, and she's taught management courses at the New School University. She's the host of the Marketing Made Easy by Jottful podcast. And Dawn is also currently writing a book about how solopreneurs and small business owners can gain sales momentum for their companies. And as noted, Dawn is also the CEO and founder of Jottful. So Dawn, thank you for your patience through that long introduction. And with that, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having me, Eric. I think as I was preparing for the show today, I was thinking a little bit about how lucky we are at Jottful that we are both trying out a lot of these marketing tactics and working with our customers on these marketing tactics too. So we're sort of really eating our own dog food here. And I think it's great that we're going to be able to discuss kind of both of that in today's show.
Sure. Absolutely. I think it's always great when you have that, what's happening for your company in real time, what we're actually discussing as a topic that applies to many people listening tonight. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to ask you, Dawn, the first question perhaps is, I gave an introduction there, but I'm wondering if you can tell our listeners a bit more about yourself and mainly what prompted you to found the company Jottful.
Yeah. So I actually started my career as a graphic designer. I studied as a graphic designer, so I have a fine arts degree. And I worked as a graphic designer for a while and then decided to switch into marketing communications. If you know anything about that, you know that marketing communications people are the people who hire graphic designers. So I literally moved over the weekend from one side of the table to the other side of the table. Mm. I worked in marketing communications for a while. So I was responsible for things like the company's website, all of our collaterals, all the brochures, advertising. For a while, I worked for a container shipping company. So even, you know, the paint on the giant containers that ship on oceans around the world. So that's what I did for a while. And then I went to business school. So I have an MBA, which is an interesting combination with a fine arts degree. And all of this combined, this marketing experience and graphic design experience, meant naturally that I was responsible for the websites for everybody I knew. So my uncle's salon, my mother's bridal shop, I just sort of fell into this as happens, right? And I was sitting there one day helping my mother out with her bridal shop website and just thinking about the fact that it was ridiculous that in 2017 at the time, it was so hard for her to manage her own website. Mm-hmm. And I started thinking about why it is. Why is it so, or was it at the time still so challenging for small business owners? And it really came down to the fact that business owners really only had two options. The first is that they could build their own website, right? So they could use Wix or Squarespace or, you know, a piece of software like this, and they could design their own website. But this requires them to have this kind of magical combination of design and technical and marketing skills in order to build something that, you know, they can actually be proud of and that they can be confident will be effective for their business. And most business owners just don't have that combination of skills, right? Their business exists for some other reason, like their employment law attorneys, right? So for a lot of business owners, the prospect of building your own website is just, you know, not possible. And you have to have the time and the interest to do it as well. So the alternative that, you know, most business owners ended up doing was hiring an agency or a designer to build a website for them. But unless you have somebody like me in the family who's doing it for free, usually you're paying $5,000 to get a website, which for most solopreneurs and small business owners is just entirely unaffordable. And so, you know, I think what's interesting about this, Eric, is that coming into the pandemic, this is really the place that we were, you know, where there were these two options. There's Jottful, and what we do is called a do it together website. Mm-hmm. So what we do is we actually take content from our customers. We take all of the text and all of the images that they want on their website, and we use it to assemble the website for them. I like to think it's like building a house, right? We take the bricks and we build the house for them. Mm-hmm. And going into COVID, really, like, those were the two options. And then Jottful has really started to gain traction in the middle. And I think that that's really critical right now because of COVID, mm-hmm. so many business owners have been rethinking their online presence.
Right. I think those are all good, interesting points, Dawn, in terms of, well, hearing what prompted you in part from personal experience, it seems to me that many business owners, many entrepreneurs, and I've spoken with many over the year so far mm-hmm. doing this show, but even in general with clients of mine, that you're right. Many people, I think, are motivated by, they see a need and maybe they see it in themselves or in their family members. Like someone mm-hmm. has a close relative who is struggling with a certain issue, then they say, why couldn't this be easier? And then entrepreneur thinks, yeah. I can make this easier. So
yep.
hearing about, say, you know, your mom's bridal shop and your uncle's business as well, and how you can help them. It's just interesting to hear that, as well as hearing about how Jottful, I like this DIT, sort of do it together mm-hmm. approach that you mentioned, that middle way, because you're right, a lot of people don't have to build your own website requires a lot of tech savvy, right? To know where the pages line up and mm-hmm. coding, and then there's content, and there's knowing the layouts and what appeals to people. So I think really, you know, really excellent points there, just that you raised.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. Yeah, I think people are oftentimes surprised by the skill set you need to actually make an effective website. Mm-hmm. And a lot of our customers actually come to us after they have tried building their own website. That's the most typical path. They try to build their own website, and then they'll come to us and say, okay, you know, I give up, or I did it for a year and it's not really been very effective. It's time for me to upgrade it. And so then they come to us at Jottful, because we're about 10% of the price of hiring an agency. So we're just far more affordable, but you don't have to build it yourself.
Got it. Yeah. I think a lot of our listeners tonight who own their own business, whether they provide an item in retail, a product or a service, can relate in some way to having clients, especially if you're a service provider, where the client tries to handle a matter on their own and it becomes too much or just beyond their, say, skill set or mm-hmm. their time investment that they have, or they're the expense and they turn to you for guidance. So it's good to have that in place. I also definitely want to hear more about this, how this came together, this DIT, and how that works for your clients and for your, you know, customers as well. I had one other question I wondered, or next question perhaps a nice segue is, what were some key changes, some new issues that you've seen with your clients, like in light of COVID-19, in terms of transitioning, let's say, to e-commerce establishments or creating online stores for their products? Anything that you mentioned COVID, so I'm wondering how that may have influenced like Jottful's clients.
Yeah, we saw a number of changes, and it was very interesting because we really saw them across the board with our customer base. So a few of the things we saw, first of all, just the number of companies who suddenly needed an online presence increased. So I think a lot of business owners thought maybe they could get away with a Facebook page or something like this and sort of avoid the situation I described earlier of the, you know, these two unsatisfactory options.
Right.
Thought they could get away with maybe just having a Facebook page and then realized during COVID that they actually needed an online presence, because the website, your website, is really the core of all your digital marketing. And a lot of these companies start doing more digital marketing, right? So we definitely saw more companies say, okay, I need a footprint, I need an online presence. We also saw people using their websites differently. So in particular, we saw them adding alert bars and things like this to communicate whether or not they were open, when they were expecting closures, what, for example, the mask rules were in their space. So we saw a lot of that more active use and more active updating of the website started to occur. Right now, we're seeing not only people talking about, you know, mask rules and these kinds of things, but also job postings, right? A lot of small businesses are trying to hire right now. And so a lot of them are beefing up the job postings on their website. And then, you know, to your point earlier, yes, we're seeing more commerce and more transactions. So companies that maybe had just a kind of basic brochure website, so merely an online presence, started to add some transaction capabilities. For example, we had, you know, farmers who would sell their goods at the farmer's market, started adding something as basic as pickup times. So you would go to their website and say what time you want to pick up whatever it was that you were going to be buying from them, because they could, there's a limited number of drop-offs they could do at the farmer's market, right? Because there's a limit to the number of people that could come through. So you can book your appointment online. So we started seeing, you know, transactions in terms of financial transactions, as well as more online appointment bookings and reservations happening.
You know, a few things there to unpack that I found very interesting. We do have to take our first commercial break, Dawn. So I'll just let everyone know that you're listening to and watching Employment Law Today. I'm the host, Eric Sauver, employment law, business law attorney. Our guest tonight is Dawn Verbrigghe, CEO of Jottful. And so when we come back, we'll talk about these key changes in websites based on COVID. And we'll talk about some of Jottful's services as well and how they changed during the pandemic. So stick around, Talk Radio NYC. We'll be right back.
Are you a business owner? Do you want to be a business owner? Do you work with business owners? Hi, I'm Stephen Fry, your small and medium-sized business or SMB guy, and I'm the host of the new show, Always Friday. While I love to have fun on my show, we take those Friday feelings of freedom and clarity to discuss popular topics on the minds of SMBs today. Please join me and my various special guests on Friday at 11 a.m. on talkradio.nyc.
Are you a conscious co-creator? Are you on a quest to raise your vibration and your consciousness? I'm Sam Liebowitz, your conscious consultant. And on my show, The Conscious Consultant Hour, Awakening Humanity, we will touch upon all these topics and more. Listen live at our new time on Thursdays at 12 noon Eastern Time. That's The Conscious Consultant Hour, Awakening Humanity, Thursdays, 12 noon on talkradio.nyc.
Are you interested in having a better relationship with yourself, others, and God? Greetings. I'm your host, Dr. George Ann Dow, for the show, A Journey Through Into Awareness. On my show, we journey into the awareness that the mind of God is the true seat of our personal consciousness. We join together each Monday at 7 p.m. So tune in on Talk Radio NYC.
You're listening to Talk Radio NYC. Uplift, educate, empower.
Welcome back to Employment Law Today. I'm your host, Eric Sauver, and here tonight with my guest, Ms. Dawn Verbrigghe, CEO and founder of Jottful. We're talking about Dawn's company and the way in which they approach website design and marketing, and the way in which they do it in a do-it-together fashion with small and medium-sized business owners. So, Dawn, you had some really great, I think, things there, observations about the changes from your customers over in terms of COVID. Mm-hmm. What I heard you say was not only about the fact that more and more people are reconsidering their online presence, but they're also using the websites in a different way. Mm-hmm. And I think anyone who's shopped online recently or ordered from a restaurant or say a company has seen like their policies around reopenings or mask mandates, which is interesting because I think a lot of websites before the pandemic, at least I noticed that many didn't really use their website as much to make announcements, right? About like say store closings or even changes in the store's policies or and so a lot of people I think maybe had static websites from whenever they were built with an occasional upgrade. I know a lot of clients of mine had the same issue and they were, you know, looking for ways to upgrade as well. So it's interesting how COVID, I think, inspired that. Is that something that you saw that was really in the beginning of the pandemic or more towards the middle or?
No, we've seen it the whole time. So what we're seeing is people, to your point, focusing less on having just a static presence and really being much more active. And if you think about the sort of pre-Jottful alternatives, if you hire an agency or designer, every time you want to make a change to your website, you need to go back and pay that person on an hourly basis. And oftentimes agencies get really, really excited about new projects where they're designing brand new websites, and they tend to deprioritize small changes like the ones you probably need, like your mask updates and stuff. So that was one option. And then people who have built their own websites, oftentimes when they would build their own website, they wouldn't look at it for another year, right? They wouldn't use that software. And then all of a sudden they need to start making changes and they have to go back and relearn how to use it. So what we do at Jottful, this do it together approach, is that we co-maintain it with our customers. So they make basic changes, we make bigger changes, like adding a page. It's just this ongoing relationship, which allows our customers to be more active on a regular basis without having to pay more like you would on an hourly basis if you were to hire an agency. And so we've been seeing this from the very beginning. Our customers are doing more blogging than they used to. They're just doing a lot more digital marketing than they used to, and they're driving a lot of that traffic back to their website. So they want to keep updating their website. We're just seeing a lot more activity than we used to see.
I think this pandemic really has created and also outlined and really shines a light on like different needs of business owners and different patterns of how they develop. I think that to your point, Dawn, about how there's more of a need like for an online presence, and there's more of a need to adjust one's website, especially because we're not in the public eye as much face to face in person. I mean, there was a period for about a year almost nearly where between lockdown, like quarantine, and a lot of places weren't having live in-person networking or events or workshops. So the need became more for what your services are. But I think COVID also created so many other demands on business owners, right? Between applying for PPP, EIDL loans, and learning like some of the employment and tax laws that may apply like for leave, complying with OSHA regulations. There's just like a lot more to do, right? So there's really a crunch on people's time and their money, because a lot of businesses took a hit financially during COVID. So it sounds as if you were able to really see a need and also an issue that was arising for your clients and customers out there in light of based on the pandemic. And so I think it's kind of good that you're able to, you know, draw that out and like recognize it and work with small business on those issues.
And, you know, we talked before about the fact that Jottful is a parallel to a lot of our businesses, right? So while our businesses, our customers, we're suddenly needing to figure out how to do digital marketing, right? Because a lot of the in-person marketing activities they used to do suddenly disappeared. Jottful had exactly the same experience for our own business, right? So we have a lot of empathy for our customers because we're oftentimes going through the exact same things that they are. And maybe I'll tell you a little bit about that, Eric, sort of what happened with Jottful. But we before the pandemic, a number of our customers would come through in-person events. So I would speak at conferences, or we would host events sort of all over the place. And I would often, you know, speak about the same topic, which is, hey, there are, you know, three ways to get a website. What's the best method for your business? And we would talk through the different alternatives and really help business owners figure out the best way for their own business to get an online presence. Right. And I would give this talk over and over and over again. And then of course, when COVID hit, everything disappeared. Right. My calendar suddenly went empty. Everybody's calendar suddenly went empty. Yep. And we thought, well, you know, this was something that was successful. Is there a way we can translate it virtually? So we said, okay, well, let's take the same content and try doing virtual events. And this was okay, but not nearly as effective as the in-person events we found. So we thought, well, what if we took it and we wrapped it up and we turned that into a short video ad that we ran at the beginning of YouTube videos? So we did that and then ultimately discovered that, hey, you know, there's something here. We do this, we run this ad and people would book appointments. So then we started really just iterating on it and doubling down on it. We hired a script writer. Mm-hmm. We hired somebody to help out with video. So it wasn't just sort of me filming from my living room, yeah. Right? Like we really started to professionalize it and level it up. And now we're in a place where we're really driving a significant portion of our business through mm-hmm. video advertising that we're running on YouTube. And I don't know if we would have discovered that growth engine as quickly as we did if yeah. we hadn't been forced to end those in-person events.
Right. That to me sounds like sort of the next second part of our topic tonight around the silver lining of the pandemic. How, mm-hmm. you know, because my guest for this show every week, it's usually three goals. One is to educate, to inform people about different rules, laws, or issues coming up around employment or employment law or business issues that people, owners face. It's also like to say inspire and motivate people as well by seeing like say like a successful story of how somebody, you know, weathered like the pandemic and how they're doing well under it. And so I think it's interesting because what you said just now, I think speaks to like this, almost this like mirror within a mirror, this Kafka-esque type of phenomenon where like the very thing you're like selling and doing as a, for your own profession, like what your company is all about, you realize that what your clients need, you need also. I think yes. a lot of us, you know, employment lawyers found that too. Hey, I, you know, I need to revamp like my own policies around hiring and firing and, you know, and paid leave. And I need to tune in like to some of these different, you know, like rules that apply to my clients for myself as well, for my business. So it's interesting that you realize that like these events, you know, that you had live weren't available. And then all this video marketing, right, video ads, you know, things like that you can do to promote with on YouTube, you know, all came from this. It's like this harsh event of the pandemic that has a silver lining. And now here you are sort of attesting to the need for your own services, right? It kind of like it validates your what was already validated, but it revalidates your existence. Like, hey, we matter. They have to give this service and it's important, you know?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, and we've experienced a number of silver linings at Jottful. Mm-hmm. So obviously the size of the market has frankly just increased yeah. during this time. More people are starting businesses. Entrepreneurship is absolutely on the rise right now. And a lot of our customers are people who are starting businesses. Our customers tend to be solopreneurs and companies with fewer than five employees. And this is just mm-hmm. really, really expanding right now. In addition to that, you have a number of companies who weren't previously online and now need a marketing presence as we've discussed. So the size of the market has really just grown. Also, the way we sell our service has changed because part of our process is that we actually give everyone who makes an appointment with us a free one-page website. Mm-hmm. We build it for them and we show it to them before they ever sign up with us because it's our way of saying, hey, is this what you're looking for? It's a way to give them, you know, an opportunity to see whether or not this would be a, you know, whether or not Jottful's the right fit for them before they ever actually pay anything. Mm-hmm. So we've always done this. And then what we do is we would get on a video call with them and we would show them this one page website that we built for them. And it used to be that a lot of our customers had never done video conferencing before, didn't know how to get on a call, didn't know how to see a screen share. And I can't tell you, Eric, the number of meetings we would have internally to try and figure out the best software we should use in order to make it as easy as possible for people to get onto these screen shares. And since COVID, my goodness, that has evaporated. Every one of our customers knows how to Zoom now. Every single one. We don't even have to ask about it anymore. We don't have to think about it. It's completely disappeared. And then the other place, you know, aside from the marketing, like discovering this growth engine, which for us was really a silver lining. The other place where we're seeing it is in talking to investors. So Jottful is what's called a software as a service company, which means that most software as a service companies do need a fair amount of investment early on because we're a subscription business. So it takes a while to sort of earn back your acquisition costs. Sure. So it's very typical to get venture capital for your business in the early stages. And for a while, when we would talk to venture capitalists, there was a lot of skepticism around whether small businesses actually needed a website. And that has also just completely evaporated. We're no longer hearing venture capitalists say things like, can't they just get away with a Facebook page? It's just not happening anymore. They're all recognizing that every business needs a strong online presence in order to be competitive.
That last point actually surprised me a bit, that venture capitalists, and I know I've helped clients with their investor agreements and their partnership agreements, stock agreements for investors, but the fact that they would be saying in 2020, when the, well, let's say before the pandemic, in early 2020, 2019, that investors would be asking if you need a website, I'll be honest, it actually surprises me they would be, I mean, so it's interesting that the pandemic answered that question and reinforced the answer.
Yeah, and not all, obviously, Eric, but some. We would hear that first from some, and we don't hear it at all anymore.
Sure. But I think it's just interesting because I think that, you know, people would think that would be a question that was answered long before 2020. And but it does show that I think what it shows me is that, you know, the pandemic has, like, say, opened our eyes, like, how much our web presence counts. That's not just sort of a side thing you do, that you check the box and say, okay, I've got a website, I recorded a couple of videos. I mean, and so it's a point I definitely want to talk with you more about. It is time for a second commercial break. So I'll just say to our audience tonight that you're watching Employment Law Today here on Talk Radio NYC. I'm Eric Sauver, the law officer, Eric M. Sauver. My guest tonight, Ms. Dawn Verbrigghe, with the company Jottful. So please stick around. We'll come back. We'll talk about some messages of inspiration for small businesses and trends in the future for digital marketing. So we'll be right back.
I am Joseph Franklin McElroy, host of the new podcast, Gateway to the Smokies. It airs on talkradio.nyc every Tuesday night from 6 p.m. to 7. Every episode is dedicated to memorable experiences in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park and surrounding areas. This show features experts and locals who will expound upon the richness of culture, history, and adventure that awaits you in the Smokies. Tune in every Tuesday from 6 p.m. to 7 on talkradio.nyc.
Are you a cannabis enthusiast, a cannabis professional, or interested in entering the cannabis space? I'm Johnny Tsunami, and this is Planet Baco Lolo, a less taboo view. On our show, we will discuss the cannabis world through the perspective of various cannabis professionals. Tune in every Thursday evening, Eastern Standard Time, 6 p.m., Talk Radio NYC, Planet Baco Lolo, a less taboo view.
Are you passionate about the conversation around racism? Hi, I'm Reverend Dr. TLC, host of the Dismantle Racism Show, which airs every Thursday at 11 a.m. Eastern on talkradio.nyc. Join me and my amazing guests as we discuss ways to uncover, dismantle, and eradicate racism. That's Thursdays at 11 o'clock a.m. on talkradio.nyc.
Are you a small business trying to navigate the COVID-19 related employment laws? Hello, I'm Eric Sauver, employment law business law attorney and host of the new radio show, Employment Law Today. On my show, we'll have guests to discuss the common employment law challenges
business owners are facing during these trying times. Tune in on Tuesday evenings from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. Eastern Time on talkradio.nyc.
You're listening to Talk Radio NYC at www.talkradio.nyc. Now broadcasting 24 hours a day.
Welcome back to Employment Law Today. I'm your host, Eric Sauber, here tonight with my guest, Don Verbrigghe, CEO and founder of Jottful. Don, really some great topics here tonight. I feel some points you're making, things we're discussing. It's good to have you on the show. And really glad you're able to join us this evening.
Thank you.
Yeah. You know, that some points you made before the commercial break, Don, really struck out at me, if I may. The whole silver lining aspect. And it's always, I find, an interesting point to raise in the show, because there are businesses out there that are really struggling and suffering and hit hard by COVID with many challenges. And, you know, I know you're not trying to in any way, invalidate like those challenges or say that, or acknowledge that they exist, right? We acknowledge them and they're tough. Mm-hmm. I think the point is that if one kind of stays in the moment and looks to see what happens and can maybe just like explore new options and new ways to do business, that you can find some kind of silver lining. And I think, you know, you found it through your video marketing. I know I'll share one of my silver linings was that I had considered talk radio or podcasting or both, put on the back burner for a long time. I had dabbled in some radio shows to see what I can perhaps get onto you as a guest or a host. Had thought about video marketing, made a couple videos and put them on the back burner for a while. And so the pandemic, it sort of like forced me to really embrace all that and do it and learn the technology. And as you said, learn how to give certain webinars with certain software I hadn't used before. You know, I'd use Zoom plenty, but but anyway, so not to take the focus off of you and your business, but the point is that there is going to be challenges like from this pandemic that even coming, you know, facing us all now. But there are changes that if we see sort of the bright side of it, we can maybe use our resources differently or see what else is out there to help us to promote and sustain our business. So I feel like some of what you talked about sort of encapsulates that in my mind.
Yeah. Yeah. I think one of my favorite examples from our customers is a chicken farmer. And they used to sell all of their chicken to restaurants. Mm-hmm. But when the restaurants closed, that supply chain completely broke down. And so they started selling chicken broth, which has medicinal qualities. And there was this, you know, interest in health foods and stuff, especially at the beginning of COVID. And they just took advantage of that. And they were just quick to adapt. They spun up a second website with us specifically for their new chicken broth side business. And that helped them stay afloat. And I just thought that was an incredible example of creativity and quick moving and just entrepreneurialism that's really inspiring.
So going back to our earlier talk about some of your services, were you able to help that company to get their online presence, their website, right, their website interface going, or was that something you're able to do for that client?
Yeah. So they already had a website with us for their farm, and then they added a second website specifically to test out this bone broth idea. And I think that was really prescient of them to realize that maybe they spin this up as a separate side business and see how it goes. So it doesn't really interfere with the narrative they have on their existing website, which is, you know, we sell chicken to restaurants. Their new website had a completely different audience, right? So I think that was a smart move on their part. And then ultimately, you know, once the restaurants reopened, they said, okay, we're gonna remain focused just on the chickens, and they closed down the bone broth piece. But that was a really interesting near-term solution for them.
So sort of a separate branding that you can do online, which I think you can do in person also to an extent, but when people go to your online presence, they want to be clear that this is a little bit of a different service that we're providing, we being the company, are providing. Yep. It's interesting to see, Dawn, all the different companies that have tried to adjust and pivot to meet the needs of customers and clients during the pandemic, and also to acknowledge the different ways in doing business that have sprung up. I know as an employment lawyer, for example, more and more companies that used to hate the remote part of COVID, the frustration of being like far away in quarantines and getting frustrated with Zoom, many of them actually have adapted either a full-time, fully remote workforce. They got so used to it and accustomed to it, they realized they can save a lot of money and capital and expense on offices and other costs. And others, I think, you know, just like reinforced that like their business needed an in-person presence. And some did a hybrid, the in-between, right? The part remote, you know, part in person. So I think it just kind of goes to show that, you know, there are ways to redo business, to restructure. And it's interesting. It kind of takes me to the next question that I mentioned before the break. We're talking about COVID and some of the trends that have happened. So let's talk maybe about some of the trends that you see in the future. Like mainly, what future trends, I'm wondering, Dawn, do you see in the digital marketing and the website design space, and how might businesses benefit from these potential new trends?
Yeah. So, you know, COVID has just really accelerated change. Mm-hmm. And so previously, business owners were increasingly going online, doing more and more digital marketing, but they were really just dipping their toe in. Mm-hmm. Now it's just the floodgates are open because a lot of the in-person activities they were doing are no longer available. They're just off the table. And so we're just seeing so much more experimentation by small business owners in terms of their digital marketing. And right. It's not just the website. And, you know, the website, again, is really, really the core of all their online marketing efforts, but they're doing other things in other channels to try and drive traffic back to their website. And on their website, they're converting them into leads or customers if they're doing transactions right on the website. Hmm. So we're seeing so much more in terms of small business owners testing advertising. We're seeing more advertising. We're seeing them test more advertising on Facebook. We're seeing more on YouTube even. YouTube's a little more challenging because it does require video, which is sort of a next level up, but we're definitely seeing more advertising. We're seeing a lot of our customers do a lot more in terms of content marketing, especially. Those who are professional services providers have really stepped up their LinkedIn presence and are doing a lot more content posting on LinkedIn. A lot of our customers are doing a lot more blogging, and then they're using those blog posts and distributing them across social media channels. Like they're sharing them on Facebook, they're sharing them on Instagram, they're sharing them on LinkedIn, wherever their audience is. We're just seeing so much more of this. And, you know, at Jottful, we've really talked about the fact that what we do is, you know, we have this do it together website, but the other piece of what we do is we actually make referrals out to our ecosystem partners. Mm-hmm. So we have across the US, we have 1,200 freelancers and small agencies that partner with us on projects. So they're logo designers, they're photographers, they're SEO professionals, they're videographers, they're content writers. And whenever our customers need help with these things, you know, we send referrals out to them, and they are all people who are specialized in working with small businesses, right? So we're not collaborating with people who are accustomed to working with IBM and Microsoft, right? We're collaborating with people who are accustomed to working with small business owners and understand what life is like as a small business owner. So we're seeing an increase in the number of referrals that we're making to our ecosystem partners because our customers are just becoming much more active with their digital marketing. So they are upgrading the content on their website, for example. So they might ask for a connection to a content writer who specializes in health writing, right? Or they want to improve their Instagram presence. And so they ask us for a connection to a photographer in their local area. We're right. seeing so much more of this kind of activity than we ever saw before.
Hmm. It's interesting because, you know, when you say that, it makes me think about how we've been hearing so much in the last, say, year and a half almost, like, wow, it's been that long, about how much like the, you know, sort of the community and the communal connections that have been, you know, squashed or broken down like by COVID-19 and the pandemic. And while that may have been true for a while, and it may even still be true for some people today, there's actually a lot of, like, say, connections being formed and made through freelancers, like through independent contractors, like through, you know, affiliate partnerships that businesses have been setting up with themselves and with professional service providers. So I think it's sort of like an interesting point that, you know, we have this this sort of crisis, and yet crisis can also mean opportunity. And so there's that chance for people to really connect in different ways, and then to kind of bring it back to their website as sort of the main hub, right? The main aspect of this is my business, my store, my product. And here are some ways to get that message across. Like, here's some ways to gain traffic, grow traffic on YouTube, on Facebook, on social media, on LinkedIn, through newsletters, and get it, and sort of channel it back to the website and to the business owner.
Yeah. Yeah. Eric, I think you made a really good point there just now about this idea of community. Yes. And we actually call all of these, you know, freelancers and small agencies in our ecosystem, we refer to them as Jottful community. And what's really interesting to me is that our customers could go to, you know, some kind of marketplace like Fiverr or Upwork where they could search for people, but they're not just looking for somebody to solve that problem today. Mm-hmm. They're looking for a relationship, somebody they can count on when, you know, they need more photos or they need more SEO work or they need more content writing. Yeah. And so they're really looking to create kind of a stable of freelancers or marketing partners or people who can help with them. They're really trying to create this community for their own business. And what we're seeing is business owners previously required those community members to be local. Mm-hmm. And now they're willing to accept them across the country. They still prefer local, but they're willing to, you know, work with people across the country and create more of that community virtually too.
I think that's a very important point there that you picked up on from my point, which is about the community not necessarily only being limited or restricted in geography as much anymore. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that, you know, we've seen that trend in business in the last 10, 20, 30 years. But with the pandemic especially, people are willing to meet a client for the first time on through a Zoom call, right? Through FaceTime, through Skype. People are willing to, say, send more documents through Google Share, Dropbox, Google File Sharing, the file sharing programs like ShareFile, and they're willing to email and communicate through text and calls, which could be, I think, for some businesses, a pro and a con, right? If you were, say, a business that dominated, you know, in your region, in your city, or your part of your state, that could be, this map is more competition, but there are also more ways to invent yourself and to be that kind of force and that presence, that influence in other states. So I think it's like a really good point. I know that for myself, you know, I've had clients that were further out. I'm a Manhattan-based attorney. My firm's in Manhattan, so very, very often for a long time, if a client were, say, living in Montauk and had an issue or matter that was going to be handled in person with different meetings or investors or groups, they want to get an attorney out in Suffolk County. And now more are willing to, right, for the consultation even, it's a long trip in. But now a consult by Zoom, some more things done online, certain meetings being moved to virtual, they're looking to talk to New York-based attorneys. So it's interesting to see how that changes. And now how does that change, let's say, one's marketing at the website? If you've been appealing to broadly, to maybe to the New York City area and what's around you, and now you want to appeal, let's say, to areas in Westchester or even, say, a little north of that, in Orange County, you know, Albany area, how do you add content? Is that a thing you're finding, that businesses say, hey, we need to add content now because we're now broadly based? We're here, we're also in Idaho, right? We're in Arizona, we're in Florida.
Yeah, and you know what? One thing I would caution business owners against here is the idea that just adding it to your website means that you are going to get customers from everywhere. We see this a lot, especially in the e-commerce area. A lot of business owners think that once they add an e-commerce store to their website and they start adding these products, orders are just going to start rushing in from all over the country. And there's actually there's a marketing piece in there, right? Just because you add the product to your website doesn't mean people are going to find it. It just means that you're now competing with every single other store in the country for that business, right? So there's still a need to really, really focus on what it is that makes you different, what it is that makes your business special. And for some businesses, you know, including professional services organizations like yours, a lot of it is about the personal attention that you bring to your service. And so if you're going to be offering more of your services online, you really need to think about how can I provide personal, you know, this personal experience virtually, how can I provide a personal experience at scale if you're going to grow your business? And I mean, that's something that we think about a lot at Jottful, and I'm sure it's something that you think about with your law firm too. And it's something that, you know, I would just caution business owners to think about before they assume that they're going to just all of a sudden get business from all over the country.
I think it's a really good point you made, Dawn. I think it's something definitely to expound on a bit, but really good for our listeners to hear tonight. We're actually up to our last commercial break. When we come back with Dawn Verbrigghe, CEO founder of Jottful, I'll be speaking with Dawn. We'll talk about some maybe takeaway message of inspiration that Dawn could leave our basically audience with. So you're listening again to Talk Radio NYC to Employment Law Today, Tuesdays at 5. I'm Eric Sarver, your host. Please stick around. We'll be right back.
Hey, everybody, it's Tommy D, the nonprofit sector connector, coming at you from my attic. Each week here on talkradio.nyc, I host a program, Philanthropy in Focus. Nonprofits impact us each and every day, and it's my focus to help them amplify their message and tell their story. Listen each week at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time until 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, right here on talkradio.nyc.
Do you feel uninformed about menopause and how it impacts on your life? Hi, I'm Pat Duckworth, women's health strategist and host of the Hot Women Rock radio show, empowering women leaders at menopause. Join me every Thursday at 10 a.m. Eastern Time, 3 p.m. UK time on talkradio.nyc for interviews with inspirational women who will share their top tips to rock your world.
Have you ever thought of reinventing yourself? Are you looking to create a new life's journey? Hi, I'm Kevin Barbaro, host of Coffee Talk XL every Tuesday night, 5, 8 p.m. Eastern on talkradio.nyc. Tune in live to hear me and my guests from a variety of different backgrounds. As a former college coach and a current full-time actor and owner of multiple companies, my show is as eclectic as my life. That's Coffee Talk XL every Tuesday night, 8 p.m. on talkradio.nyc.
You're listening to Talk Radio NYC at www.talkradio.nyc. Now broadcasting 24 hours a day.
There we go. Welcome back to Employment Law Today. Almost forgot to unmute there. I'm here tonight with Dawn Verbrigghe, CEO founder of Jottful, as we mentioned, a company that specializes in website design, development, marketing, and so much more, as you can hear tonight. And so, yes, Dawn, just if I may recap some points, motivations that I heard from you tonight, from your responses. Like, you talked about, you know, just the way that the needs of your clients and customers have changed a bit from the pandemic, how the pandemic has highlighted certain online needs and also highlighted the need to change one's website to be more interfacing with customers and to be more, like, say, positioned for taking orders or selling items or things of that nature. We also had, I think you really hit some good points for our listeners to think about in terms of, say, the business model, you know, pivoting and adjusting to the pandemic and sort of seeing some of the challenges that we're all facing, but also seeing ways that we can use this and these challenges as an opportunity, right, to pivot, to adjust, to promote, to use online marketing more than ever. So really interesting talking with you about that and all the other issues around COVID. And then lastly, your sort of how you as a company found this growth. So I thought that all would be great for our listeners to kind of chew on and think about as I ask you another question, which would be, if you had a message of inspiration, and I feel like a lot of what you said is that, but if you had a message of inspiration to give to our, like, small to mid-sized business owners, what would be their takeaway you can convey about a successful pivot?
Yeah, so I think for a lot of businesses, one of the most difficult things to do is to figure out where you're going to get your sales momentum. Mm-hmm. What is going to become the growth engine for your business? How are you going to reliably and predictably generate profitable leads for your company? And this is a frustrating, it can be a very frustrating process. I know that we went through it at Jottful. We came out of it the other side. I interview every week for the Marketing Made Easy by Jottful podcast. I interview business owners who have gone through this process and come out the other side. Mm-hmm. And I just want to give some words of inspiration to the people who are currently in this process. Yes. Know that it is a process. It is a period of time. You're going to be testing a lot of things. You're going to be throwing a lot of spaghetti against the ball and trying to see what works. You're going to be iterating. You're going to have more failures than you're going to have successes. Your successes are going to be small, but when you find them, double down on them, because that's how you get to the big success, is by doubling down on all your little successes. And every business that gets to the other side is in a position where they are able to grow predictably and reliably. And you can get there too, because I have seen every kind of business get there. So you can get there too. I can't predict how long it will take because it's different for everybody, but if you persist and you're consistent and you're thoughtful about it, you will get there too.
It's a great message for our audience to take away, especially since everyone, as you mentioned, like has their own process. And I think it's an important point you made, Dawn, that you know you can't always know how long the trial and error, how long the error part is, and how many failures it takes to get to a success. But if one hangs in there, right? If you hang in there, then like success can be yours for the taking. I think it's a great point. I think it's like really inspiring. You know, you talk about this, the process, how you were able to do it with your company. I appreciate that. I think it's a very helpful, note to give our audience tonight to chew on. And so we're not yet at the close. We're coming towards the close. Of the show, if you can believe it, always goes by so fast. And now here we are. I want to give you 2 minutes, and then I'll take a minute to take us out. But just to give our audience maybe like some anything you want to share about your company, any of upcoming podcasts, any events, any online talks, or the floor is yours. I'd like to
contact you. Yeah, yeah. So first of all, in case you were wondering how Jottful is spelt, it's Jottful. So you can visit us anytime at jottful.com. If you want to send us an email, you can just send an email to hello@jottful.com. We're happy to answer any questions you have. But if you're looking for some more information about marketing, I can make a couple of recommendations. One is that Marketing Made Easy by Jottful podcast, which is every single week. And you can listen to it wherever you get your podcasts. Another is if you go to jottful.com/MMM, that's for Monday Morning Marketing. And that's an email that we send out, as you might have guessed, every Monday morning. Sure. And usually it's 5 quick marketing tips. And a lot of people tell us that they actually read that on Monday morning and see if there's anything they can implement in their business or test in their business that week. So that's a really great resource. It's just a quick tips email every week. So I hope that these things can give you some inspiration and help you grow your own business.
Excellent. Dawn, thank you so much for that really great conversation tonight, this evening, and the wrap up as well. I think it's like really important for businesses to hear not only about services that they need, but also about how they can be inspired and motivated to grow. So really good stuff coming up. You mentioned your email. Good that you spell the company name also. I think people tend to forget that we're live on video. We're also live on the radio and audio. So good to have that as well. I will just take a moment to wrap up, and I'll say that folks, you're listening to Employment Law Today. I'm your host, Eric Sauber, employment law, business law attorney, representing companies and management, and I have this show every Tuesday night, Tuesday evenings from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time here on Talk Radio NYC. If you like what you've heard tonight, you want to hear more shows of this cloth, feel free to tune in. You can catch us on Facebook, on the Talk Radio NYC Facebook page, or the website. So once again, Dawn Verbrigghe, CEO and founder of Jottful, thank you so much for joining
us. Thanks for having me, Eric.
You're very welcome. A pleasure to have you this evening. Wishing all of our audience tonight a good night. I'm Eric Sauber. host of Employment Law Today. Thank you all, and be well.
Thank you.
Thank you.